Social media are ubiquitous in our daily lives, and the controversy surrounding them has followed a familiar arc. Initial optimism in their ability to connect individuals and foster networks has given way to widespread concerns regarding their role in spreading misinformation, stoking polarization, and affecting users' mental health. So, what does the evidence say? Are social media good or bad? This paper sheds light on this question by providing the largest-scale experimental evidence to date on the way Facebook affects a wide range of individual outcomes. With 2.3 billion monthly active users, Facebook is the world's largest social media company and has featured squarely in the broader discussion of social media's dangers. To study its effects, the authors implemented a randomized study in which US users were paid to deactivate their accounts in the run-up to the November 2018 midterm elections. Between September and October of that year, study participants were recruited via Facebook display ads and randomly assigned to receive an offer of either $0 or $102 to temporarily deactivate their accounts. Before these offers were revealed, participants completed a survey in which they were asked to provide the smallest dollar amount they would be willing to accept in exchange for deactivation. The offers were then revealed, and those whose willingness to accept was less than their assigned offer were asked to deactivate their accounts for the following 4 weeks. To estimate the causal effect of deactivation, the authors focus on the subsample whose willingness to accept was strictly less than $102. Among this group, those who were randomly assigned to receive an offer of $102 and who were therefore asked to deactivate are the treatment group, while those randomly assigned to receive an offer of $0 and who were therefore not asked to deactivate are the control group. Outcomes were collected via several sources, including surveys, voting data, and responses to daily text messages sent to measure participants' well-being. The first set of results study substitution. Deactivating Facebook frees up approximately 60 minutes per day for the average person in the treatment group. How is this newly available time utilized? This figure shows that deactivation not only reduces time on Facebook, but also reduces time spent on other online activities, while increasing time dedicated to offline activities, including watching TV and socializing. This supports the claim that time on social media crowds out face-to-face interactions. The bottom of this figure examines the impact on news consumption. While, as expected, deactivation reduces reliance on Facebook as a news source, there is no compensating increase in other areas. Instead, the authors estimate that deactivation simply reduces total news consumption by 8 minutes per day, or roughly 15% of the control group's average of 52 minutes. This brings us to the second set of results on news knowledge and political outcomes. Consistent with the previous results, users who deactivated their accounts report paying less attention to the news and score lower on a quiz used to measure their news knowledge. While this lower exposure doesn't appear to have any impact on political engagement, as measured, for example, by whether users voted in the 2018 midterms, the authors do find evidence of a reduction in polarization. This figure shows that the distribution of opinions held by both Democrats and Republicans in the sample shift inward after deactivation, indicating a reduction in polarization. The authors estimate that this decrease corresponds to roughly 42% of the overall increase in polarization in the US since 1996. Thus, while Facebook plays a role in helping people stay informed about current events, it also leads to increased polarization. What about another common concern? Namely, that social media has a negative impact on users' mental health and well-being. The authors find that deactivation does in fact lead to improvements in well-being, particularly in terms of self-reported happiness, life satisfaction, and less depression and anxiety. The overall index improves by 0.09 standard deviations, which is roughly 25 to 40% of the effect of psychological interventions such as therapy or group training, as measured in other research. Given these positive effects on well-being, it seems plausible that the experience of deactivation itself might lead users to change their Facebook habits going forward. And indeed, both planned and actual Facebook usage falls for the treatment group after the end of the experiment. Interestingly, however, there is no clear change in users' opinions about Facebook. Instead, deactivation leads users to better appreciate both the positive and negative impacts of Facebook. These results shed light on the myriad ways in which Facebook affects its users. But how do we tackle the broader question of whether it is good or bad? One approach is to focus on users' own assessments of how valuable Facebook is to them. The mean willingness to accept for deactivating Facebook among the study's participants was $180. Aggregating this number across Facebook's 172 million US users would yield $31 billion in consumer surplus for just 4 weeks of Facebook. The authors do point out that deactivation led treatment group members to reduce their valuation by 14%. Nevertheless, this smaller number would still imply that Facebook generates considerable consumer surplus. So, where does this leave us? The authors conclude that, on the one hand, it is clear that Facebook provides very large benefits to its users. The platform serves as an important source of information, and even after experiencing a 4-week deactivation, users still spend a substantial, if reduced, amount of time on the platform, and would need to be paid large amounts of money to give it up. On the other hand, this study also shows that the downsides, in terms of lower subjective well-being and increased polarization, are very real. The authors are upfront that their results should be interpreted with caution for several reasons. For example, their participants are not fully representative of the average Facebook user, and the effects would likely differ according to the duration, time period, and scale of the deactivation. Nevertheless, this paper serves as an important contribution to providing hard evidence and a measured assessment of the effects of social media. To read more on this topic, you can check out the full paper and its references to other related research. These include many papers studying the effects of social media, other attempts to measure the economic gains from free online services, and finally, a much broader literature quantifying the impact of media technologies more generally.